Good morning. Welcome to our service here in Myroe Presbyterian Church. We're delighted that you can join with us today as we meet together to praise and to worship our Almighty God. Welcome also to all those who are listening to our online service at home. It is good that you can share with us. We want to extend a special word of welcome to Rachel this morning. Rachel has very kindly agreed to play for us today while James is working. We pray that you will know a very warm Myroe welcome. We are thankful that so many boys and girls have been coming along to our children's church each week. Thank you to all those involved in facilitating this work. We are now very familiar with the routine ensuring a safe entry and exit to the buildings. Thank you for all your cooperation in this matter. Thank you for continuing to wear a face covering throughout the service. This morning, we asked you to pray very earnestly for our minister, Reverend Jones. Reverend Jones is presently in hospital. Please pray that soon he will be well enough to return home and that God will continue to sustain him physically. Please do prayerfully remember Elspeth and his family, as no doubts this will be an anxious time for them. Anyone requiring the services of a minister should contact me. Our Holiday Bible Club will take place tomorrow, Monday the 9th, Tuesday the 10th, and Wednesday the 11th of August. We're excited to hear that a good number of children have already contacted Andrew to let him know that they will be coming along. The theme for this week is Run the Race, and all primary school age children will be made most welcome. Each day starts at 10:30 a.m. Next Sunday, the 15th of August, we look forward to hearing about and seeing some of the work which has taken place throughout the week. Our Holiday Bible Club leaders will take part in our special Holiday Bible Club service. Please do encourage your young people to come along. We need to move the chairs over in the hall. We would appreciate some help with this. Please meet over in the hall after our service if you can help. Thank you. We want to welcome the Reverend Dr. David Murphy back to our pulpit again. We pray that as you come to bring the message which God has laid upon your heart to share with us today, that the Holy Spirit will apply this word to your hearts. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I want to say thank you to Richard for his very kind words of welcome. It is my pleasure to be back with you here in Myroe Presbyterian Church, having shared on a couple of occasions previously. We come together as a congregation of God's people to worship God, to praise him, to lift up his high and holy name. The psalmist in Psalm 146 says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live." We're going to praise God now as a congregation as we sing the opening hymn, In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
We join together now in prayer. Let us all pray. Our Father, we thank you indeed for the words we have just been singing. In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. Our Father, we thank you for your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is the rock of all ages, the one who has provided and procured salvation for us, wonderful, full, and free. For he died that we might be forgiven. He died to make us good, that we might go at last to heaven, saved by his precious blood. Our Father, we come and we bow before you in prayer, and we come to acknowledge who you are, to lift up your high and your holy name, to acknowledge that you are good in your greatness, and that you are great in your goodness, that you have loved us with an everlasting love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. We come and thank you, our Father, for all the blessings of this life. We thank you for bringing us safely through the hours of darkness to see and behold the light of another new day. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Our Father, we praise you and we thank you for the blessing of home and family life, for those who are our nearest and our dearest, those whom we love and those who love us in return. We thank you, Father, for a portion of health and strength in order to get out and about and to do what we would want to do. We thank you for our daily bread and for all the provisions that you shower upon us, more than we could ever possibly number. But our Father, we thank you most of all for your spiritual provisions in Jesus Christ, your Son. Truly, we are able to say, in Christ alone, my hope is found. And yet, our Father, we are very conscious that even as we recall your love and goodness to us, we are very conscious of our sin, of those times when we have disregarded your way and your word, when we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our feelings, in our words, and also in our actions. Father, forgive us. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Renew a right spirit within us. Enable us more and more to walk in the paths of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that as we gather here this morning, in this morning hour, we pray that you will bless us with the very real sense of your presence. Work within us that which is good. Instruct us and teach us from your word in the scriptures, so that in the remaining hours of this day and in the days that lie ahead, that we will step out with you, walking in the paths of your righteousness, and so doing for the honor and for the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. I want to read this morning from the Psalm 119 and the section from verse 49. Psalm 119, that lengthy psalm of 176 verses, each of which has something important to say to us about the Word of God. Psalm 119 and reading from verse 49. Let us hear the Word of God. Remember your word to your servant, for you have given me hope. My comfort in my suffering is this: your promise preserves my life. The arrogant mock me without restraint, but I do not turn from your law. I remember your ancient laws, O Lord, and I find comfort in them. Indignation grips me because of the wicked who have forsaken your law. Your decrees are the theme of my song wherever I lodge. In the night I remember your name, O Lord, and I will keep your law. This has been my practice. I obey your precepts. Amen, and may God bless this reading of his word to all of our hearts. We're going to sing again as a congregation, this time the hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us, How Vast Beyond All Measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How deep the Father's love for us. join together once again in prayer, let us pray. Our Father, we thank you that you encourage us to bring our fears and our concerns and our worries unto you, so that the strength of your presence may calm us and support us, and the truth of your word remind us of your undying love for us. And so, our Father, as we bow before you once again in prayer, we pray that you will give to us the spirit of intercession as we remember the needs of others, as we remember the needs that we have ourselves, and as we bear before you the work of your church. Our Father, we do remember those who are led aside with sickness at this time on this Sunday morning. Whether they be at home or in hospital, those perhaps belonging to the congregation, those known to us in our own respective families, we pray, Father, that you will be with them, that you will set your hand of healing upon them. We pray for the Reverend Jones, minister of this congregation, and ask, O Lord, that you will be unto him also as he would need at this time of hospitalization. Pray that you will be with all in his family. Surround them with your everlasting arms. And we pray for ministry to the needs of the body, for healing and for soothing. Our Father, we pray for those who have been bereaved, whose hearts are heavy with sadness and sorrow. We do acknowledge that the wound of bereavement is a very deep wound, and that even with the passage of time, even years, the loss of a loved one is still acutely felt. And so we pray for those who mourn, whose hearts are sad. And we ask, O Lord, that you will bless with a very real sense of your presence, because when we discern your presence with us, then we know your peace even in the midst of the storms of life. We pray, Father, for the work of the congregation, remembering the Children's Holiday Bible Club this incoming week. We thank you, Father, for those who have utilized their skills and given their time to organize the activities for the boys and girls and the young people. We pray, Father, that you will bless the lessons that will be taught this week from your word and all the various activities that have been planned. We ask, O Lord, that the boys and girls will come to know more about you, and in coming to know more about you and of your love for them, that they will come and put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Our Father, we pray for this work this week in this congregation, as we pray for a similar work in many other congregations across our country. We ask, O Lord, that you will indeed set your hand upon every endeavor where the gospel is being shared and where the invitation of the same is being declared. As we come now to look to your word as we have read it this morning, we pray, Father, that you will bless us too as we wait upon you in these moments. For the congregation gathered here and for others who will listen online, we pray that you will bless us now, that you will direct our thoughts to you, that you will indeed work within us that which is good and draw us closer to yourself so that we will leave here at the end of this service, knowing that it was good to be here, because in waiting upon you, you have truly strengthened our hearts. Father, may it indeed be so. We pray together in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Well, this morning we read from Psalm 119, that great psalm of 176 verses, each of which has something to say to us about the excellence, the importance, the relevance, and the imperishable nature of the Word of God. Now, before we look at some of the pertinent points from our reading this morning, found in verses 49 to 56, I want to note initially another verse in this psalm. It is verse 19. Where the psalmist says, I am a stranger in the earth. And we could say that he recognized that he was a stranger in at least two different ways. First of all, in the sense that as one who trusted the Lord and who sought to follow the Lord, his way was often at odds with the ways and the prevailing culture of the world in which he lived. He was living in a society which really had little or no time for the things of God, as we are too. And as a result, he was often looked upon as being out of step with the world's views and thinking. And so in that sense, he was a stranger in the earth. But in another sense, he was also a stranger in that he knew that his life in this world would not last forever, that death is the destiny of every person, and that no one can save himself or herself from the power of the grave. In the second application of his acknowledgement of himself as a stranger in the earth, he is recognizing that he is a traveler, that he is on a journey, he is on a pilgrimage, and that pilgrimage or journey will end when, in a physical sense, he dies and leaves the scene of time. A stranger in the earth. We are all on such a journey. My own personal life's journey started when I was born, of course, in the Mid-Ulster Hospital in Macrafelt in County Londonderry. That journey continued as I grew up in my childhood days, living just about a mile or so outside the town of Cookstown in County Tyrone. It took a dramatic change when I got married 45 years ago on Friday past, the 6th of August, 1976. And at that time in my life, I made the journey 10 miles to go to live in the town of Dungannon, where my wife came from. Still, of course, in County Tyrone. In time, my journey here in this world took me and my family back to County Londonderry in 1991 to the village of Ballache, where we served in the church along with the congregation of Knocklochrim. And there we served for just over 7 years. And then 23 years ago now, our journey took us to Cullibackie in County Antrim, a new county for us. And then in May of last year, back to County Londonderry, to Port Stewart in retirement. Now, in all of those years, where the place of residence has from time to time changed, but never changed dramatically with respect to distance and or geography, because Northern Ireland is, of course, a small place. There have, however, been occasions when we have had the privilege to go beyond the counties of Northern Ireland, already mentioned, to different places in Ireland and beyond. And all of those experiences and those trips and tours are part of my pilgrimage and the pilgrimage of my family through the journey of life that we are on. Now, in many ways, it's a fairly modest journey compared maybe to some people who travel quite extensively, who may have lived for some considerable time in one or more far-off country because of work commitments and the like. Our journeys are all different. When I think of my late father in his life's journey, he never once left the shores of Ireland, and probably only on a couple of occasions did he ever leave Northern Ireland. For him, he was happiest and at his most content in familiar surroundings, as indeed many are. He used to say to me, "I don't know why you go off to all of those places on your holidays. A couple of weeks in the moss will give you a good suntan there." Our journeys are not all the same. And along the way, we experience different things. Yes, our journeys are different. And as we travel, we all have our own personal hopes, ambitions, and aspirations, all of which are coupled, of course, with our fears, our concerns, and our worries. And in the midst of all of that, God is calling us. as he used the prophet Haggai to call the people in his day. God is calling, and he is calling us to consider our ways, to consider what it is we are living for, to consider what our chief goal in life really is, to consider what our end will be when the journey here in this world ceases. For in this sense, like the psalmist, we are strangers. And so God calls us to consider what we will do and how we will respond to his love as expressed in his Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I mention all of this morning because the psalmist in verse 54 of our reading from Psalm 119 refers to his pilgrimage or journey through life. And he says there, "Your statutes have been my songs in the house of my pilgrimage." In actual fact, he is really saying here that God's word is his song wherever he lives, wherever he goes, wherever he lodges. In the journey of his life, God's word is the new song in his mouth and is the joy of his heart. The psalmist sees himself as a pilgrim, and a pilgrim is one who is on the move, who is traveling from one place to another, and as he travels, the psalmist is acutely aware of the fact that this world in which he is now living is not the only world which he will experience or live in. For he knows that he is on a pilgrimage to heaven, to the house of the Lord, to the place of the many mansions. Here in this world, we have no permanent resting place for the soles of our feet. Here we have no true home, for we nightly pitch our moving tent, a day's march nearer home. And one day we will strike our tents for the very last time on earth and be ushered and welcomed into our heavenly home in the land where the day never fades. This morning, as we recognize and acknowledge the pilgrimage of life that we're all on, and as the psalmist here recognized that he was on too, can you say with confidence and with assurance that you are indeed marching to a heavenly home, and that you are marching because you have received Jesus Christ as your Savior and been saved by him? I look back over the years of my journey thus far and would safely say that 40 years ago, I never dreamt that one day I'd be a minister in the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. But that I became because of crucial moments in my life's journey. Becoming a Christian by repenting of my sin, by giving my life to Jesus in faith, marked a significant turning point in my life in the year 1982. Yes, it was a time when I decisively accepted Jesus as my Savior. But on looking back from where I am today, prior to that time, I can see how God was working in my life, primarily through His Word and through His people and through circumstances, to bring me to the place where I gave consideration to my ways and to my relationship with God, and to the realization that no longer could I resist His call. The Shorter Catechism explains to us what the effectual call is. Effectual calling is the work of God's Spirit, whereby convincing us of our sin and misery, enlightening our minds in the knowledge of Christ, and renewing our wills, He doth persuade and enable us to embrace Jesus Christ, freely offered to us in the gospel. A significant moment in the journey of my life. A moment that no doubt many of you here this morning have too experienced. But maybe a moment, the moment of salvation, that some here this morning are listening have not yet experienced. And God is speaking to you. He is calling you, as He called the people through the prophet Haggai. He is calling you to consider your ways and to in faith receive His Son. Begin a new chapter in the journey of your life. A new chapter that will enable you to stand with the psalmist, as we find him here in Psalm 119 and verse 54, and say to God, "Your statutes are my songs in the house of my pilgrimage." And why was the psalmist singing? He was singing because the Lord had saved him. David's testimony in Psalm 40, verse 3, was that the Lord had put a new song into his mouth. A new song to praise the Lord God Almighty. As we journey, we often sing. Soldiers in marching off to war have been heard singing. Children may sing as they travel in a car or a bus. Protesters marching for some cause or supporters traveling to watch their team will sing a song appropriate to the occasion. Singing helps to cover the miles of the journey. And it is interesting to note that immediately after Psalm 119, we come to that section of the book of Psalms where we have 15 psalms that are referred to as the songs of ascent. And these songs of ascent were sung by God's people as they made their way at festival times from where they lived up to Jerusalem. Pilgrims singing songs of praise. As we journey through this life as pilgrims and travelers, it is our delight as the children of God to similarly sing, to sing songs that will respect and honor the Word of God. For in the Word of God, the way of salvation and Christian living have been revealed. Your statutes have been my songs. And the psalmist so desires to sing, because the Word of God is precious to him, as indeed the Word of God is precious to all who profess the Christian faith, who know eternal life in Jesus Christ, and who have the assurance of heaven. Why is this so? Why is the Word of God so precious? Let me suggest briefly a number of reasons. First of all, the Word of God is precious because it reveals clearly the end of our journey. For the Word of God has so much to say to us about the beauty and the loveliness of heaven. A place where in Revelation 21 says, there will be the complete absence of weariness and tiredness. A place where there will be a complete absence of fear and danger. A complete absence of sin, sorrow, and death. For all of those things in heaven will give way to life and light and peace and joy for all eternity. Secondly, the Word of God is precious because it contains all the directives we need as to how to travel as we march to our heavenly home. And thirdly, like the psalmist, we say to God, your word has been my songs. For God's word runs over with promises to support us along the way as we travel. It contains all the prescriptions of God that we need in order to comfort us, and to deal with our suffering, to deal with the perplexities and the losses that we all encounter in the journey of life. It is evident that the psalmist knew much of such support and comfort. The word comfort is mentioned by him in this section, in verses 50 and 52. In verse 50, he says, this is my comfort in my affliction, for your word has quickened me. In verse 52, he says, I remember your judgments of old. O Lord, and have comforted myself. As the psalmist journeys on to heaven, he testifies to the goodness of God. He remembers the word of God, takes great comfort in it, sings of it. And as he does so, his spirit is lifted and he finds comfort and support in his time of need. There is a book that comes to me from one who spake of old, who calls with shepherd voice the flock that wanders from the fold. There is a book whose page is white, a wondrous love reveal. A love once wounded unto death, the wounds of sin to heal. There is a book whose promises I all my life may plead. They shine like stars above the night of my exceeding need. There is a book whose pilgrim songs are sweet as songs of spring. I hope to sing them till the day when I shall see the King. That undoubtedly was the psalmist's testimony and desire. Is it yours today? Do you know the joy of salvation, of having been saved by the grace of God? Are you journeying on to heaven, being strengthened by the promises and the provisions of God's word, as the psalmist was, and by the presence and the power of God, until that time when the pilgrimage in this life here will be over and the Lord will take you home to heaven, saved to sin no more? I trust that you are so journeying today, and that wherever our paths may take us in life, and they will all be different, that one day we'll meet again in glory, and there be reunited with those who in the Lord have gone before us, those whom we have loved and lost just for a little while. May it indeed be so, and may God bless his word to all of our hearts today. Let us pray together. Our Father, we thank you that the psalmist is able to say that you brought him out of the horrible pit and out of the miry clay, that you set his feet upon a rock, you established his goings, and you put a new song into his mouth. And Father, we thank you that in knowing Jesus as our Savior and Lord and friend, and we too are able to sing a new song just like the psalmist. We pray that you will enable us to continue to do that as we journey through life, meeting as we all do life's many challenges, yet still being able to sing because of the wonder of your word, the promises that we find contained therein, and there as we read of your power and your might and your strength. So, Father, bless us each one personally and individually. Bless the congregation as we journey on in this life. In faith, may we journey singing our songs of praise unto you, our God and our Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to conclude the worship this morning as we sing the hymn number 500, God of Grace, Amazing Wonder, Irresistible and Free, O the Miracle of Mercy, Jesus reaches down to me. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.